so much. All the way right here at the throne. And we're going to have Mr. Bob Higgins come forward and just share a short testimony about his story.
Thanks, Douglas. Well, it's a privilege to be here. My wife would be here with me, Joni, and but we had paid to be at another conference, but I had to come to this one. So, but there's such an anointing here, and thank you, Larry and Grace, for such an anointed music, and. Thank you, Doris and Douglas, for your leadership here. Just briefly, I'm very thankful that when I grew up in a divorced family, and my dad had married 5 times, my mother had married 3 times, and we lived with grandparents and all over the place, ended up as a hippie in the 70s, long hair. And went through that whole scene, drugs and drinking and everything, but the Lord miraculously saved me when I was, I finally had come to the, I had been busted. You come to the end of your rope and you realize, where's my life going? It was a wake-up call. And I started, off and on throughout my life, I'd been exposed to church, but I'd never been exposed to the Holy Spirit. And so when I was finally ready to, okay, God, what have I got myself into? I don't want to end up like this, going to jail and a terrible life. And the Lord brought someone into my life and invited me to a chapel service. Actually, it was a Catholic mass. And I was dating a girl that she was Catholic, so that's okay, because I didn't really know enough about religion. I'd been in so many different ones, I didn't know which one was the right one, to be honest with you, Baptist and Catholic and all that. So, but it was the meeting after the mass that we got invited to the side room, and they said they're just praise and worshiping, and I didn't really know what that meant, but we thought, okay, and my host, you know, he was the one that invited me, so I thought we have to go with him, you know, he's going in there too. And that's where I got exposed to the charismatic movement of the 70s. Yes. I didn't know what that meant. And it was beautiful music, just like what we had tonight or today, very anointed music. And they were all in a circle, kind of a kumbaya, but I was hearing different languages, you know, speaking of kumbaya. And of course, I'm in the Air Force thinking, well, maybe there's international people here, but it was beautiful music, worshiping the Lord, and some in English and some in other languages. And they're sharing different words and speaking out with authority to different people, telling them things about God. I had never experienced anything like that. And so I got a Bible and started reading, and they started telling me where the Holy Spirit was, and it just came to life. The New Testament came to life reading about the Holy Spirit, and I didn't know about the gifts of the Spirit. And so my girlfriend and I, and that's my wife now, Joni, that's what really brought us together when we came to the Lord and got the Spirit filled. And then we ended up in the Assembly of God. Wow, they really had it together. And we really took off in the Assembly of God. And I started praying, Lord, what is for my life? And we got rid of all my rock albums and everything. And I started finding Christian music. And I like rock, so I found Christian rock. And it was like, wow. And I'm like, Lord, why isn't there music like this on the radio? Back then, in the 70s, there wasn't Christian radio stations. Well, at least like what I like. I think there was the gospel stations. And next thing I know, I'm listening to the Air Force radio station. They said, we need volunteers to come down to the radio station. Now, I'm a medic by day. I work in the emergency room, medic by day. I ended up becoming a disc jockey by night. I trained. I trained, and when I said, Lord, why isn't there music? I said, guess what? The Lord used me to start a Christian rock radio show for 2 years in the Air Force. And, you know, you talk about separation of church and state. The station manager, he said, now, what kind of music you want to do after I got trained? He said, you know, back then they had soul, disco, top 40, all that. I said, I want to do Christian rock. And, you know, he almost swallowed his cigarette. He said, what is that? You know? And so I put on some, I actually had an Amy Grant album and put it on. He thought that sounded like top 40. So he let me have a radio show based on Amy Grant. I was late, years later, I was able to tell her that story that she helped get me into the ministry. But from that point on, the Lord started pulling Joni and I out of the Air Force. We felt led to get out, and we were out of the Air Force for a week. Lord, what are we going to do? We want to serve you. And my mom gets a call from the Christian TV station. And we go, Mom, what do they want you for? And she said, they want me to come down and give my testimony. And 2 weeks before we got out of the Air Force, she was watching the Christian station, and she had a really bad backache for 3 days. She couldn't sleep in her bed. She was on the couch, couldn't get comfortable. And on the TV station, a minister said, there's a woman out there, you're on the couch, you have a bad backache, you are going to get healed right now, stand up and receive your healing. And she stood up and said, that's me, and felt the warmth on her back. And he said, call in and give your testimony. So now, a week later, now that I'm, God's timing, right, to get out of the Air Force, to come and stay with my mom. We said, we'll stay here for a few weeks till we get a job, and then we'll get our own place. And they call and say, Mrs. Kimmel, we would like you to come down and give your testimony about getting healed when the minister called you out on television. And she's telling us about it. I said, Mom, I'll drive you down there. I've never been in a TV station. So I drive her down there, and she's up on the stage giving her testimony. I'm not hearing a word of it, right? I'm all of a sudden now, coming from 2 years of radio, I'm seeing cameras, lights, action, all of this stuff. And I'm hearing the director in the camera next to me. I can hear him, you know, zoom in, pan left, all this. And I just like, wow, this would be amazing to work here. And when the interview was over, the show ended, and now the minister that had interviewed my mom, he's walking toward me. And he said, your mother said you were in the Air Force and you were worked at the radio station, you know all those buttons and knobs. I go, yeah. He said, well, I want to hire you. I was like, wow. So that started a 7-year career learning everything about television. So God pulled me out of the Air Force, put me into the Holy Ghost TV training there in Detroit, Michigan, WGPR, did a lot of Christian shows there. And then I had a prophecy one night. I was helping my mom do a cable access show because she was very anointed. And the minister at the church said, young man, I see you on the world stage of television with the latest technology equipment. Now, the ministry I worked for in Detroit, we had just, you know, basic level cameras, you know. We weren't a TBN or PTL club back then, and 700 club and all that stuff. But he said, I see all that. And it wasn't long after that I got a call from TBN to go work at TBN, and they had me manage a station. And from there, I started working under Paul Crouch. He made me vice president of distribution, helped TBN get 100 million homes. He passed away, and then the Lord said, you've got a new assignment. And I prayed and fasted, Lord, what? And I got a call already about working for a Christian movie network. And I said, Lord, should I do this? I'm going to leave the world's largest Christian network to work for the world's smallest. The Lord showed me the importance of the stories that he told, the parables. And he also did the sermons. When I saw that balance, I said, Lord, we didn't know that in TV, and we were just mainly preaching and teaching, Daystars preaching and teaching. So we need to get the stories out there with all these Christian movies. And so the Lord gave me the green light, so I started heading up Parables, the first Christian movie network. And then from there, we launched Uplift TV, and got, because Parables is on the internet, so you really, you know, you try to get subscribers and all that, but you're not reaching the masses. Not everybody can find the website and all that. So we started Uplift TV, and that's where we did that balance of movies and ministries, just the way Jesus communicated with stories and sermons. Because, you know, people can't always remember a sermon. Sermons are important, but you can ask someone, you know, what did the preacher preach last week? Like, oh, they try to remember. And you don't want to say that when you're next to the preacher, right, if you can't remember a sermon. But if you ask someone about a movie that came out 10 years ago, oh, yeah, they could tell you everything about it. That's how our brains are programmed. And so that's what the Lord's doing is with Uplift TV. It's on DirecTV channel 379. We're going out on apps. We're going to go on a big deal to go out all over America on the apps through the Amazon, Roku, and all that stuff. And it's going to get us into millions more. But the Lord's showing me that we have to start reaching America with the movies, anointed movies, so that the secular people that are getting all the HBO and the Cinemax and Cinelot and all those networks out there, that they can now get some Christian movies and they can see how real Christians live.
Yes.
Because the secular movies, they like to show Christians as the, you know, they're awkward, they're out of touch. They're weird. Sometimes they're the bad guy. You know, the pastor is the evil guy of the movie.
Yeah.
And that's Satan distorting. Yeah. He's trying to marginalize Christianity and do away with it in secular society. So we have to raise up Christian anointed movies and dramas and series, all of that stuff, and get that out there. Let's let people get hooked on a Christian series and get these movies on Netflix and Hulu and all that stuff. So that's what I'm doing right now, and I appreciate your prayers for us. And if you can watch Uplift or go to parables.tv and get Parables, but keep us in your prayers. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bob. I was so impressed with Bob that I went out and I signed up for DirecTV, and It's been wonderful, and thank you for producing that and making it available. We're going to take just a short second, and I want to ask Lauren Norris if he would do just a little brief giveaway to our guests right here. Lauren, will you come up and let's get something exciting going on?
More exciting.
So how many of you have a testimony? Four people raised their hand. Are you kidding me? How many of you have a heartbeat? Then you have a testimony. Here's the only question to your testimony. When you tell your story, are you testifying to the glory of God or testifying about your past? Think about that for a second. When you share your testimony, do you spend more time giving glory to the destruction Satan did in your life, or more time giving glory to the God who changed you?
Amen.
So I'm going to ask for the person who has not yet silenced their phone. If you have not yet silenced your phone, I have a free CD for you. Now, this is the content that was taught at Gateway Church as a three-part series for helping people learn how to share their testimony. I also want you to know that both Doris and Douglas are always looking for people who can share the glory of God and how the Holy Spirit has touched their life in this environment. If that's something that you would like to be able to master the heart of storytelling is something that will help you learn how to do that. My professional career is helping people be better communicators. So I'm going to give away two of these that are single CDs. And the first one goes to the person who can look at their phone right now and show me they forgot to silence it. Come on up here. Found her. The rest of you, please look at your phone and make sure that it's silenced. Otherwise, while we're recording and live streaming today, when your phone goes off, I'm going to turn the camera right at you while you're taking it out to turn it off. you are certainly welcome. I hope you enjoy that. I'd love to have your feedback on it. Okay, the next single CD is for the person who drove the furthest to get here today. Flying from Nigeria doesn't count. Who drove the furthest to get here today? How far did you drive, Harold?
I drove
from Baltimore to Redo. From Redo. Anybody further than Redo?
Well,
Douglas, like, takes a camel back from him. Oh, Douglas doesn't count. He said Douglas doesn't count. Okay, Harold, come get it. Anybody further than Redo? Anybody? Nobody further than Redo. All right. All right, and the last one, this is actually two-part. This one has both the Learn to Roar and the Four Eyes, Impact, Investment, Influence, and Inspiration. So this is a two-part CD. And I want to give this one to the one who knows for a fact God has put a book in their heart, but they have not bothered to write it yet. There's three of them. Doris, you have access to me easily. Come get this. Y'all give them a big hand. I also understand the sweet ladies from the Wisdom Center, by way of Dr. Mike Murdoch, have brought some gifts for you all. They're goodie bags at the back. You can ask Pastor if you'd like to know what's in them. But those are for you on your way out the door. Just grab one of those goodie bags and be blessed. And thank you again for being here today.
Thank you, Lauren. That's fun. He's got some great stuff. He has leadership on the brand new every morning on the web. And so if you, how's it listed on the web?
You just go to either Facebook or YouTube and look for J. Lauren Norris, and you'll find it every day at 6:20 a.m.
Thank you, Lauren. We're at the time right now of introducing our keynote speaker. And what a great opportunity we have to learn from a great man. And he's an architect, and everybody in Nigeria seems to be an architect. No, that's a joke. Just a lot of people within the fellowship. I would like my friend Adito. We were in Lagos in 2013, and in the last day, he is speaking on a part of the Bible of Lazarus. And so as I'm sitting on the platform with a couple other FGB MFA people, looking right across from me is one of the kings. And he makes out a yell, and he falls flat on his face. I said, I think he's dead. And sure enough, he's surrounded by Nigerians. They're all doing spiritual warfare. And after a few minutes, well, actually, it seemed like about 20 minutes, Mr. Adito says, okay, take the king away. And he gets up and he preaches on Lazarus being raised from the grave. He finishes the message, the parable, the story, and he gets to sit back and they bring the news. The king is alive. He comes to the platform. We have about 40,000 people there at this crusade, and they go crazy. They went absolutely crazy. So, and I was one of them. I was one of them jumping up and down on the platform, excited about that. The king is alive. And the king is alive. So with that, we're going to ask Mr. Vito to come forward. And he has a great testimony to share with us. So let's welcome him right now.
So nice to be here. I love young people. What a warm atmosphere we're enjoying this afternoon. In that meeting, it was the story of Lazarus. But today, it shall not be about Lazarus. It shall be about me. and about one more person called Jabez in the scripture. Jabez is a character that was born in a generation of failed men and women. People that were rejected, dejected, despised, forgotten, and about to waste. But suddenly something happened to him. The beauty about his story is that in his generation, there were seven brethren. And each of these had some negative traits attached to their dads. The first was called Asher. And Asher meant darkness. The second was called Hela. And Hela meant a laughing stock. The third was called Jezua. Jezua means a refuse dump, a garbage. And the fourth was called Jabez, which meant sorrow, pain, affliction, and grief. And the fifth was called Eshtim. Eshtim means a weakling. And the sixth, Pesiah. Pesiah means stagnated, a crawler, just like a snail. And the last, the seventh, was called Enahash, which means poisonous, abode of serpents, dangerous serpents. But you know, all these men, apart from Jabez, died in their pains and in their wicked dispositions. But Jabez looked at himself and did everything humanly possible for him to do, but there was no help coming his way. But somehow, the Holy Spirit whispered into his ears and said, turn to the God of Israel. And when he turned to the God of Israel, he made a simple prayer. He said, that thou wouldest bless me indeed. And from that moment, the Lord visited him and turned his captivity and broke the spell of Satan over his life. And emancipated him from his captivity, and he became a celebrity. And that is the story of this man standing before you this afternoon. Isaiah chapter 60 verse 15 summarized my life story. It says, whereas you have been forsaken and hated, that no man would want to pass through you, I will make you an eternal excellency and the joy of many generations. I was forsaken. I was abused. I was despised. I was relegated. As though nothing good could come out of me. But I struggled. I could recall in my days, just as I rounded up my university college education, on the day of award, you know, prize presentation, we call it graduation night. We were so many, University of Nigeria, about 5,000 people in the auditorium. And suddenly, when it was time for my faculty, the best graduating student in the Faculty of Environmental Studies, I had my name. I seated at the back. And I went to the aisle, right to the front, and collected my prize. As I was going back halfway to my seat, my name was called a second time. I turned back, the best graduating student, Department of Architecture. I came forth, I received. As I was returning, it was called the third time, the fourth time, the fifth time, the sixth time, and the seventh time. The entire auditorium was electrified. And as I bagged the seven faculty prizes, returning to my seat, halfway, I suddenly discovered there was ovation on the left, on the right, everywhere. Tears began to roll down my cheeks. Now, there were mixed feelings, tears of joy on one part, the 7 faculty prizes. The tears of pain on the other side, because I missed my first class degree by a reason that was only peripheral to my academic pursuits. A relationship between one of our lecturers and one of the fellow, a female fellow student of mine. This was what cost my first class. So I wept very bitterly. But then, just after that, I recalled that that was not the first time. It happened in the primary school, it happened in the high school, that each time I was getting close to hitting the ultimate mark, some wind, some evil wind, will just come forth and blow it off, and I will land at average. Even when I graduated, I sought an employment somewhere at FCD, Federal Capital Development Authority in Abuja, the capital city of Nigeria. And lo and behold, at the end of the interview, the chairman of the panel just wrote at the back of his complimentary card, CV in my office, you know, way back at Suleja then, after the next day. And I was wondering, what could this be for? I went to his house and I met him. And he said, congratulations, that I had the best performance of those that attended the interview. But then that he had a different idea. Why should I take up a government job? Let's float a farm, architectural farm together. He was also an architect. So that he will make sure that we have jobs, but I will be responsible for implementation. And then we'll make sure that we have a very successful farm. I jumped at it, I celebrated it, and I resigned the old job I had and carried my things and came to Abuja. And I met him. He said, that's all right, we'll meet in the office. When I get to the office, he said, let's meet at home in his residence. When we meet at the residence, he will use me for domestic entertainment, indoor games, one after the other. Started with Scrabble to Monopoly to chess and the rest of them. 3 months we were playing games. After 3 months, there was a coup d'etat in Nigeria. And 2 weeks later, he was kicked out as a director. And that expectation was dashed completely. So I identified that I had become a target, a victim of a pathological case of near success syndrome. Getting close to hitting great success, on the edge of it, some evil force will just come and scatter it. It became very burdensome to me, and friends asked me to seek for solutions. First part of course, 6 and 7 books of Moses. I don't have time to talk about it, but I put it to test and it failed. Second part of call, Abdul Rashid's Great Message, in the Light of Truth. I put it to task, it failed, and I ran away from there. And a lot of other ventures and adventures that I went through, I could recall that it got to a point where we floated as a social club just to help ourselves, professionals of like minds. But then, these were stuck unbelievers who would always sit in the evening around tables, drinking, partying, smoking, and all that, just to encourage ourselves, even in our distresses. But you know, time came. One day, a good friend of mine went through my house with his wife and passed the night. And while we were sharing the living room, he began to ask me questions, and I shared my life's plight, my experiences with him. And he pulled out a small pocketbook. Later I discovered it was a Bible, a New Testament Bible. And he just read a passage to me. In Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, it says, come unto me, all ye that labor and the heavy laden, and I will give you rest. This struck me like an arrow in my heart. Say, who is speaking? Say, the Lord Jesus is giving me an open invitation. Say, you will give me rest from all my ordeals? Said yes. And he added the second scripture in Proverbs chapter 23, verse 18. He says, surely there is an end, and the expectation of the just shall not be dashed. Wow, this is all I've been looking for. Will it apply to me? He said, yes, if I give my life to Jesus. Right there, the Lord convicted me of my sins, and I began to shed tears like a baby. I excused myself, ran into the bedroom, and wetted my pillow thoroughly. And the next morning, I shared my experience with him. My heart was flooded with joy. There was peace like a river. There was an assurance of salvation. There was a newness of vision. There was a newness of purpose. It's like I was just born afresh. I couldn't describe it because it was so ecstatic. And he directed me, because actually he was on his way to a convention of the full gospel taking place in the city of Jos at that time. You know? So I accepted it. And the next week, I went to the first full gospel chapter in Abuja. And right there, I publicly gave my life to Christ. But you know, that was just the beginning of new things. One of the greatest experiences that I had was the baptism of the Holy Spirit. It so empowered me that beautiful afternoon that immediately after the kind of meeting we're having here, I drove about 50 kilometers to meet one of the Muslim king ruling one of the hamlets close to Abuja. He was my friend. He's been my friend for some time. Why was I there? To share the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ with him. I was just fresh in the Lord, but I bubbled with such an image. I felt, look, everybody that had to do with me must receive this kind of experience that I had. It was awesome. Now, when this happened, a number of radical transformations began to take place in my life. The first was, God, get me rest. The near success syndrome gene in me was terminated. The scripture that says, if any man be in Christ, he is a brand new creation. All things are passed away, all things have become new. That moment. You know, in the football, in the soccer, when the referee lifts up a red card to a player, what happens? He bows out. So I could literally see the Lord Jesus lifting a red card to that wicked spirit of near success syndrome. And he bowed out. And from that day, the Lord ministered to me. He said, I have seen the diligence of your heart and your commitment to my cause. And I have come to lift you up. I will lift you to a platform of envy. The heathens around you will be rattled and they will envy you, but there is nothing they can do about it because your righteousness is of me. Amen. By the time he finished speaking, I broke down on the floor. I was weeping. I said, Lord, what do you see in me? My wretched self. At that point in time, I had nothing doing. I was just confused, confounded, roaming around. I had suffered from the spirit of stagnation, the spirit of limitation, moving around to vicious circle. But you know, the Lord said, yes, I know. I know your works. I have come to set before you an open door, and no man can shut it. I accepted the verdict, since it was the master that was speaking. I thought it's going to take some decades before the Lord will begin to manifest the things that he began to say to me. But you see, right after that, he began to strike in very, very dynamic manner. The first thing he did with me was to give me the most precious, adorable wife. Sweetheart, incredible woman, great virtues, and blessed us with three children, two boys and a girl. Our son just finished his PhD in London. Our daughter just finishes her master's in pharmacy. And the baby of the house is still in the university reading architectural engineering. And together, we have committed our lifetime to the furtherance of the gospel of Christ. And on account of this, each time we are on the field, just like I'm here in the US for the past 1 week, by the time I will be getting home, next morning is already awaiting me. Amen. testimony is already awaiting me. I give you one or two of the things that the Lord did with us, and I will invite us to pray. The first, there was a time we had a full gospel retreat, we call it advanced in Nigeria. And when I got home, a friend just came walked up to me and said, look, I have a shop, a location, and I want to sell it off. I said, how much would that cost? And he said, if you give me $200, I'll be fine. I at that point in time, I couldn't boast of $200. I had just about 100 or something, but the Lord made it up, and I bought it. And after a short while, the same lawyer that drafted the agreement, the attorney that drafted the agreement between us, came back and said, some company would want to rent that same shop, and they will rent it at $330 per annum, and they were willing to pay for the first 3 years. And, you know, $1,000 came in just within a week. And later on, that shop was sold for $30,000. The following week, in very quick succession, I bought another of similar shop at $165. And a few years later, it was sold for $60,000. Now, capital was coming in. As I was going for an outreach again, on the way, my phone rang. And a friend said, where are you? I said, I'm just traveling to Benin City. He said, no, you must come back. I said, no, I can't come back. He said, why? I said, because I'm on the Lord's assignment. That was on a Thursday. I said, why do you want me to come back? He said, no, there is this urgent need. I needed to submit my company profile for a tender with Central Bank of Nigeria for total facility management contract. I said, no. If it's of the Lord, it must wait. So I proceeded. He said, no, it was too urgent, it will not wait. I said, that's all right, let it be. So I went for my meeting. I came back Sunday. The moment I landed 30 minutes later, he called. He said, are you back? I said, yes, I'm back. He said, please, where can I meet you? I said, I thought you said it could not wait. He said, no, don't worry. Please, where can I see your profile? The next morning, I gave him my profile. 2 weeks later, we got the letter from Central Bank. It was a contract for total facility management in one of the branches of Central Bank of Nigeria. And in this, we were netting $150,000 monthly for 3 years. Wow. Monthly for 3 years. God is awesome. One thing I discovered that from the day that the Lord spoke to me, he says, I have given you rest from your labors. Amen. And from that day, I ceased looking for business. As I went after his righteousness, the kingdom of my Father, his righteousness, the things that the Gentiles outside there are seeking after will be roaring after me. All that I do every morning is I will just have my quiet time and pray and say, Holy Spirit, what do you want me to do today? If you want me on the harvest field, I will go on the mission field. If you want me to do one or two things over there in business, I will say, what exactly do you want me to do? More often than not, in business area, he will send whosoever that he wants to be a client with us. Both in our architectural work, in our real estate, in our hospitality, and in every other thing that he had ever called us to do. That's exactly how God has been dealing with me. For the past 20 years, I have never sought or applied, sat down to begin to apply for a contract of any business. Instead, these businesses come knocking on the door of our homes. We did a few architectural jobs, and some days, some state governors, we're just driving through. And they say the children of the governor in the same car with him says, Daddy, wait, this is the house we like. The only house that we want. And the driver stopped, and the man came down and asked for my security man who was in the premises and said, please, who is the owner of this house? He says, one architect, so. And he said, please, give him my card, ask him to call me. And when I call the governor of the state, and I say, I introduce myself, I say, you drop your card for me. He said, when can we meet? I say, if you want me to fly in the next day, I will fly in. And the next day, I flew in. And there and then, he gave me a commission, a job, a great job to do. And this is how God has been moving us from one level of his glory to another. It's been awesome. It's been wonderful. In protection, someday, I had an invitation. I live in Abuja, to go to Port Harcourt, which is just about 600 kilometers away from Abuja, for an outreach. I got to Sheraton Hotel to pick my ticket. The lady that was there on the airline desk was so busy, could not even as much as lift up her head to look at me. She was busy writing. And when I tried to inquire, I said, excuse me, madam. She said, can't you see that I'm very busy? It became very abusive. Ah, I said, I thought I could just pick two tickets, one for my wife and one for me. She said, please, I am busy. She was just arrogant. And on account of that, my spirit went low. And the Holy Spirit said, leave her. And I left her. As I was leaving, I saw another airline desk, and I went there. And I asked that guy, I said, can I have a ticket to Port Harcourt? He said, he had only one ticket left. And I wanted to go with my wife. So I bought the only ticket left. And the next day I told my wife, she said, don't worry about me, you go. So she stayed back and was praying for me. 2 days later, we flew that airline. As we landed in Port Harcourt, 10 minutes later, that fixed airline, their plane landed and crashed. Port Harcourt. And everybody inside there, except two, died. I never knew that God was using that lady to tell me, I don't have space for you in this coffin. Snatched me away. And I would have been there with my wife. It's incredible. I was in my office one day and a young man just walked in, filled the form. He wanted to see me when it was his time, he came in. Before I knew it, he started unbuttoning his shirt. I said, what are you doing? In the office? He said, excuse me, please permit me to do this. And he removed his shirt, pulled his singlet. Behold, lacerations, open wounds all over his body. No. I said, what's this? He said, please, that's why I came. We are a group of bandits, armed robbers. A number of times we terrorized your streets and we made efforts to rob you violently. But we never succeeded. But after one of the last attempts, confusion came into their midst. They had misunderstanding amongst themselves. And on account of that, they started exchanging bullets, gunfire, amongst themselves. And two of them were killed. And the police came in and arrested them. Eventually, they were tried and sentenced to prison. And he was in prison. You see, now while he was in prison, that a week before then, that the Lord appeared to him and told him, look, if you don't receive Jesus, you will perish. And the next morning, full gospel members came, the set free chapter, and ministered to them, and he gave his life to Christ. And the night after that, the Lord came again and said, now, a week after, you will be released from prison. Now, on account of this, you must look for that man that you wanted to rob violently and make restitution and make him pray for you, that if you fail, that you will be rearrested, brought back to prison, and you will die in prison. He said, this is why I came. You are that man we wanted to kill in one of our robbery operations. But the Lord said, no. Please, can you forgive me and pray for me? Of course. We forgave him and prayed with him and gave him money. Went to hospital to treat himself. And he became a vibrant member of the Full Gospel Jesus Men's Fellowship in Hong Kong. Thank you. God has showed us great mercies beyond our wildest imagination. beyond what we can ever explain. Let me say this. I visited a doctor friend of mine once in his hospital. And when I was coming into the entrance lobby, the waiting room, I met a woman that was very pregnant, in fact, due for delivery. But she sat at a corner, weeping profusely, weeping so profusely. As I inquired about the doctor from the receptionist, he said the doctor was not on seat, but that he would soon be back. So as I went to sit down, the Lord said, go to her, meet that woman. So I attached myself to the woman. I said, woman, what is the matter? Why are you so lonely? She said, if I must listen, that I should sit down. And I sat down, and she began her story. That I've seen her condition of pregnancy. I said, yes. She said, she had been in that condition 3 times before that. And 3 times, she had stillbirth. She will carry 9 months pregnancy, but it will end in stillbirth. That I could see 7 years into marriage, she doesn't have a child. Now, this is the 4th pregnancy. She's supposed to be due for delivery, but the doctor is telling stories. What are the stories? That her blood pressure was too high, and her sugar level was also too high. So she could not even attempt cesarean section. On an account of that, they have referred her to Gwagwalada Specialist Hospital in the Federal Capital Territory of Abuja. And she said the husband has deserted her because they had no more money. So she was in between life and death as she sat there. She said the doctor has abandoned her. Said there's nothing he could do for her. They should just go to the specialist hospital. But the Lord said, that's why you came. That's why I brought you. And I ministered to her. To cut the long story short, I held hand with her and we began to pray. After about 45 minutes of intense fervent prayer, we said amen. And I decided to leave. The receptionist called me and said, the doctor had come in. So I went and met the doctor. And the doctor said, maybe it is just because of this woman that God brought you, that her case is just hopeless. He didn't know what else to do. But you know, I went home after that. The next morning, my phone rang. It was the voice of this woman. He said, immediately I finished that prayer, labor came. And before I knew it, the doctor accepted her, took her into the labor room, and she brought forth a bouncing baby boy. Yeah. I was not asking, hey, son, would you mind if I name this boy after me, after my name? I said, wow, my name means Ifeanyi Chukwu. With God, nothing is impossible. I said, why not, since it glorifies God? It is not me, it is Jesus that has done it. So do it, go ahead and do it. And today she is a mother of 3. I went to Kano. We finished the meeting, big meeting, about 3 times the size of this. And during ministration, the Lord laid in my heart, pray for those trusting God for the fruit of the womb. As I called them, they came forth. At the extreme end was a woman, a young lady, but she was right at the back, weeping profusely again. I said, please, ushers helped that lady to the front, and she came. I said, are you married? She said, yes. Where's your husband? The husband was seated at the extreme left end. She was at the extreme right end, you know, as the east was from the west, because so much tension in between them. I said, do you have a child? She said, no. I said, why are you not among those in front? He said, her case was different. What made your case different? He said, I won't understand. I said, that's why I'm asking you. He said, the doctors have removed her womb because she had some medical condition complications. And they gave consent and they had to remove the womb. So even if I come, I don't have a womb to carry me. I said, who gave you the womb in the first place? He said, it was God. I said, where is that God? Is he alive or dead? He said, I believe that he's still alive. I said, if he's alive, you don't think that he could replace the womb? I said, you are the target. You are the first person that God will want to minister to today. And we just put our hands on her. I said, Lord, you brought the womb in the first place. Replace this womb and give this lady a miracle. And we we finished and went home. 14 months later, it was the voice of this woman on the phone. The miracle had happened. A set of twins. The Lord replaced twins and gave them a set of twins. And the gynecologist to that, they said that, no, did the surgery and everything, was there at their dedication, saying this can only be miracle because he knew what he did. And tied the woman, gave it to them in a polythene bag, and they went and buried it. But here they are, brand new womb, a set of twins, a boy and a girl. Is God not awesome? God is awesome. You see, we are rash, thou hast been forsaken and hated, that no man will want to identify with you. You see, I will make you today an eternal excellency. He will wipe your tears away. He will migrate you from the platform of shame to the platform of his glory. That's what God has brought us here to do. Anywhere we went, we have seen the manifestation of his glory. Everywhere we went, we have seen it. Graciously, it pleased the Lord. God brought us from it, just like David in the wilderness. And he went there and brought us out and brought us to serve him the capacity as the national president of the Full Gospel Businessmen's Fellowship International in Nigeria with 3,600 chapters. Nigeria alone, and about 150,000 men as members. By the time they add their wives and children, we begin to count better. God has put aside this meeting to do something spectacular in somebody's life. I don't know you, but God knows you. I don't know what you have come, what you have passed through in life. I don't know the burden that you carry. I don't know the yoke that has hindered you and tied you that you cannot excel above your highest imaginations. But one thing I know, that I could hear the voice of the Lord saying, it shall come to pass on that day. And that day is today. That the burden shall be taken away from his shoulders. And his yoke, the yoke of the devil, will be taken away from your neck. I say, and the yoke shall be destroyed by the anointing. Whatever be that yoke, whatever be that burden, today is the day of its termination. Amen. You shall be set free, and you shall be free indeed. That is the word. God is not looking for the qualified. Don't think, look, I'm such a terrible sinner. I don't qualify for this. No. He's rather looking for the sinner to be made a saint. He's looking for the foolish to be made wise. He's looking for the weak that he will make strong. He's looking for the naive that he will brighten up his horizon. He's looking for that person that is a debtor, that he will wipe away his indebtedness and make him a lender of nations. Yeah. That's God for you. Who is that mediocre that God wants to make to make a celebrity today? It doesn't matter where you are today. By next time next year, you'll be singing a new song. Something extraordinary would have happened to you. Before I close, I was in Renovonkish meeting in Abuja. And before he closed the meeting, he said, there is somebody here. You have a friend and a brother who is indebted to you. And this brother is going through some sleepless nights because of that debt. And the Lord is asking you, forgive him. Right away. And this came at a time that we took some credit facility from one of the banks in Nigeria called Global Bank to do a big project that God led us into. And the Lord said I should write off the indebtedness that architect in UBC. He is also an architect friend of mine. And I forgave him $30,000. It was very painful because I was owing the bank myself. Very, very good sum of money. Now, when we finished the meeting, as I was leaving, I didn't know Architect Ndubisi was in that meeting. As I was heading to my car, lo and behold, a young man and his wife. I called him, I said, please come. The moment I beckoned on him, and he took about 3 steps towards me, his wife fell on the floor, collapsed. He thought I wanted to traumatize the husband. I wanted to ask for my money. Because it has been a big burden to them, just like the man of God said. I didn't know that they were going through that level of distress. And we rushed and helped her up, resuscitated her. And I said, Andy, please, I have a word for you. And he managed that, and he came. And I said, the Lord said that I should write off that debt. When I said this, the man himself fell on the ground. And now the wife at a distance, seeing the husband fall, she fell again. So the crowd gathered, everybody. Now, he fell for joy, but she didn't understand that he fell for joy. So she fell in distress. But you know, we don't know how little things, especially acts of forgiveness, what difference it could make in the lives of people around us. It gave them a new phase of life.
Yes.
But you know what? A month later, 30 days later, God came knocking. And he wrote out for us 150 million naira, which was about, at that time, $90,000 debt. He canceled for me. Say, God, you are awesome.
Yes.
You are awesome. I didn't know that little debt this young man was owing me was the key to my miracle. I don't know who you have locked up in your heart today. The person might have caught you or taken advantage of you or done some silly things against you. But the Lord is saying in this year, forgive. If only you will forgive, heaven will forgive you. And will redeem you from every indebtedness. One thing the Lord did for me through that experience was, there was this evil gene of indebtedness running through the lineage of my parents. They were always in debt. You know, just like most of us in America, always in mortgage, servicing debt, servicing mortgage. I grew up seeing my parents each time. At times the police will come, harass them, carry this and carry that because they're owing or they're running late in servicing their mortgage. But I say, God, I don't want to continue with that kind of life. And the Lord says, yes, I know, and your case is different. Because the word says, if any man be in Christ, he is a brand new creature. All things are passed away. All things have become new. You see, because of what you have done and you encounter in the Lord Jesus, I'm going to flush away the evil gene that I inherited from my parents. And he will replace it with his glorious gene of victory. And that's exactly what I experienced from that day. On that day, never again will it be said that I'm indebted to any institution. Instead, I can count the number of banks that are indebted to me. Because they have my money. I fix my money with them. And they are doing business with my money. So they are indebted to me. Ladies and gentlemen, a story of 60-something years cannot be told in 20 minutes. But I'm just giving you a little glimpse of the faithfulness of God through his son Jesus in my life. And I want to invite you to share this experience that has been so amazing in me, my family, and everyone round about me. It's been such a precious, ecstatic experience. That I want every friend of mine, every acquaintance, everybody I meet, I owe that person this duty. Come to Jesus. He's the ultimate. There is nothing as sweet as Jesus. Nothing as fragrant as Him. Nothing as assuring as Him. He will forgive your sins, forgive your debts. And He is going to give you the assurance of salvation that you are no longer afraid of death. Death is, I wait for everybody. Yes, everybody must die. But look, those that die in Christ only but sleep, waiting for the day of resurrection. There cannot be a better life than this. Yesterday was my encounters, but today shall be your encounter. If the Lord is prompting your heart to open it up, to receive this Jesus that is right now at the door of your heart and He knocks, if you open, He will come in. Yes. He will sup with you. He will give you this transformatory power that will change your life and your destiny. If you want to say yes to Him, I just want to pray with you. Just lay your right hand on your chest. I will pray with you. Yes. If you want to receive Jesus, please just put your right hand on your chest. I will just pray with you. Want to make Him your Lord and your Savior? Want to say, yes, Lord, I've heard what He has done with Mr. Odedo. I know You can do it, and even better for me. Make this your prayer as you pray with me. Say, Lord Jesus, thank You for speaking to me today. I have conviction in my heart. I'm a sinner. I can't save myself. But Lord, come into my heart, save my soul, be my Lord and my personal Savior. From today, I will live for You. I hand my life over to You. Manage it as it pleases You. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, as many that once that same power of the Holy Spirit, you are born again, or you have rededicated your life to Christ, and you want to receive that power of the Holy Ghost, so that you have that boldness to be a witness for Him. Anywhere you are, wherever you are, whatever circumstance, no matter how adverse, you will stand strong to share His love anywhere. Your testimonies will touch your generation. Is there anybody like that? Want the baptism of the Holy Spirit, this is the time. Anybody want to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit? You want that gift of power? Bible says that you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. You shall be my witnesses. Anybody want to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit? All right. Now this is ministry time. It's time to deal with the issues of our health. Issues of our health. It doesn't matter the reports you have received from your physicians. The report of the Lord is superior. There is nothing too terrible that God cannot redeem. No situation too bad, too ailing that God cannot heal. That's why He is the great physician. This morning, do you have any ailment you can identify in any part of your body system? The hour is now. God wants to give you a testimony. Let's bow our heads again. Let's close our eyes. And you want this prayer, just stand where you are. You are not coming to the front, just stand where you are. Stand. Let the miraculous power of God touch you now. Please stand. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. We don't do big man for God. There is nothing like pride when it comes to God. Because if you are proud, the enemy will insist on bringing you to ridicule. And he will disgrace you. Yes. Can I give you 30 seconds to whisper what that need is to the Lord? What that pain is, what that ailment is, what that desire is. Next to this, I want to pray for those who are trusting God for fruit of the womb, trusting God for a baby, for a child, in a legitimate marriage. Please, can you join me to one? Stand. Stand. You can even stand for your daughter, you can stand for your son, you can stand for a brother, a sister. Please stand. If there is somebody who wants to stand in the gap for this moment, please stand. By this time next year, according to the season of life, a testimony will resound to God's glory. Thank you, Lord. Finally, I want to pray for those who are in debt. You are owing somebody, or you are owing an institution, or you are owing any form of organization, and it is bringing you a heart trouble, some debt, indebtedness. Please, can you stand to debt? Yes. Any form of indebtedness. Any form of indebtedness. I could hear the Lord telling me 90 days, it shall be completely over. Amen. 90 days. 90 days. Don't ask him how it's going to be, but he says 90 days. Tonight, count it. This 10th day of February. 90 days. 90 days. Thank you, Lord. I give you praise. I give you praise. Thank you, Father. Can we just lift our right hands unto heaven? Just raise it unto Jesus. He is the author. He is the finisher. He is the healer. He is the deliverer. He has the empowerment. When he says yes, no man can say no. When he opens a door, no man can shut it. Thank you, Lord. Father, every hand lifted up is lifted unto you, acknowledging your supremacy over their life situations, circumstances, over the ailments, the sicknesses, the diseases, the infirmities, over every such indebtedness. It doesn't matter whether to individuals or to organizations or to government. Every indebtedness. The spirit of barrenness, unfruitfulness, Lord, wherever it is and wherever it has come from, I bring it before you this day, asking, Lord, that you will scourge it with the fire of the Holy Ghost in the name of Jesus. Lord, set your people free from sicknesses and infirmities. Bring healing upon their lives from the crowns of their head down to the soles of their feet in the name of Jesus. Make them every which whole in Jesus' name. Lord, you said 90 days. And this indebtedness shall be wiped away. Wipe it off, Lord. Wipe it off. In the name of Jesus. Let them return with testimonies that you have done great things. In the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, you say none shall be barren in the land, and none will cast his yoke. On account of that, let the power of fruitfulness come. Let the power of fruitfulness come. Let the babies be conceived now. Thou that calleth those things that beeth not as though they were, bring it into performance now. In the name of Jesus, that by this time next year, testimonies will abound to your glory. In the mighty name of Jesus, I give you praise. I bind the spirit of limitation, the spirit of stagnation, the spirit of near success syndrome in the lives of God's people. I bind you, I cast you out of darkness in the name of Jesus. If the Lord makes you free, then you are free indeed. Thank you, Father. Blessed be your name. In Jesus' name we pray.
Receive mine as well. from torn Achilles to a cornea transplant coming up to cataracts, and also the removal of Parkinson's from me. And I receive that healing now in the name of Jesus. So I stand before you and I will make testimony as it all occurs. And praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Yeah. I'm going to ask our brother over here. He has something special to tell us, how we can be a mover and a shaker and be a part of this incredible organization.
Thank you, Douglas. Good afternoon once again. Have you been touched and blessed by the testimony you heard? If you have, let's just give a clap of unto the Lord. 10 years ago, I joined this great fellowship. And I tell you, my life has never been the same. My business turned around. Just as he was sharing, I remembered also at a point before I joined the fellowship, I had led a reckless life. I was a businessman, I'm still a businessman, but had led a reckless life, and at a point I became broke. And I was being owed by a certain young man, and I planned to do certain funny things to him. But just like in a meeting like this, the Lord also asked me to reach out to him in China and forgive him. And it was difficult, but I did. And a few months later, after so many years of owing the banks, owing friends, living in shame, I got one job from an oil company in Nigeria, and that singular job turned my situation around. And from that day to today, I have understood the purpose for which I was blessed the first time. And today, if there's anybody the Lord is looking for to go out there to sell Jesus, I am that person. I travel around with my brothers, just like we are here, preaching and reaching out to fellow businessmen. And today, I'm calling on each and every one of us. We have an opportunity to join this great fellowship. This fellowship is just about testimonies like this. We're not a church, we don't intend to be a church. We just come together, hear beautiful testimonies like our brother just shared. If you want to join this great fellowship, you want to be a part of us, the Four Gospel Businessmen's Fellowship International, America, may I see your hand? May I see your hand? Including old members that want to renew, may I see your hand? It doesn't take anything. Membership is just being born again, being filled with the Holy Spirit, and an annual subscription of $40 for men. The ladies are free. So you want to join, please, may I see your hand? We'll just pass a form to you. You want to renew your membership, can I see your hand as well? We'll just pass a form to you and you'll fill the forms, please. Can I see your hand? There's a lady here, thank you. May I see another hand, please? It's an interesting organization, very interesting. Some other person wants to join us? If you're having doubts about who we are, I mean, I know that some people are in their hearts thinking, who are these guys? Maybe you can meet Douglas after now, get his email, get his contacts, find out more about who we are. We're not a church. We're not in competition to the church. We are here to complement the church. I was sharing with a sister over there a few some minutes ago. What we do is we go to golf clubs like this, hotels, restaurants. We organize meetings like this. We reach out to men that don't go to church. More ladies go to church than men. Do you agree with me? So the men are playing golf, then hotels, then restaurants. So we'll reach out to them in hotels and restaurants, and we'll sell Jesus to them. And after they get saved, they come to church. So you can see we're not in competition to the church. So you want to join us in reaching out? You want to join the American arm in reaching out? Please, we're looking for members. May I see one hand? One more hand. God bless us. Thank you. Did you enjoy that powerful testimony?
Wow.
I think it gets better every time I hear it. And what excitement. What excitement. Yes. If you want, we're officially going to dismiss, but if you would like prayer for anything, we have prayer warriors and everything that will be here to pray for you. If you have any question about the Full Gospel Businessmen Fellowship in America or Nigeria, we will be here. And we welcome and thank you for being here with us this afternoon. What a pleasure it is to get to be able to meet you and to know you. And we hope that you will be coming back to be a part of what God is doing through the Full Gospel Businessmen. So blessings to you. And I'm going to have Roy Bryan close us in prayer.
Thank you. We do want to thank you so very much for joining us today. If you bear with my voice a little bit, it's been an honor. We're going to be seeing you again this summer. We have our national convention coming up in July. You have notice of that. But right now, let's just go to the Father. Hallelujah. Daddy, it's been such a wonderful time before you with your people today. We just thank you for your awesome presence here. And Father, that by your promise you travel with us, that you go before us. Father, we thank you for opening the doors that no man can close. Father, we thank you for the awesome anointing that you allow to bestow upon us. And Father, I thank you that we can continue to be in the image of your Son, Jesus. And in his name, we thank you. Amen.
Well, thank you once again. We're going to be here, and we have some extra testimonies, so if you want to take Adito home with you, please do. We have these wonderful flyers that you can share. Doris has got to... Grace and Larry had to leave early, and you had just you're officially dismissed, but here's a little message.
Yes, hi. God bless you all. As you can see, Larry and Grace are not here anymore, and that's because they actually have a program this evening that is called Miracle Service of